We want everyday individuals to see themselves as change makers.
Todos y cada uno de nosotros somos agentes de cambio.
You are the best suited to create the solutions for the places you come from.
I think what we now see around the world is that folks are desiring a new reality, and we want to help folks create that.
Hello, and thanks so much for joining us. I'm Carol Jenkins. The program is Black America, and today we are welcoming back a wonderful guest, Jamira Burley, who is an activist, the co-founder of I Am Here Too, and she'll tell you all about that, what you're here to do. Jamira was recognized by the Obama White House as a champion of change and a Forbes Under 30 honoree in law and policy. Jamira, thanks so much for being with us again. I am delighted to have this opportunity to catch up with you. An extraordinary life history. You're so young. I mean, to talk about it in that way. But now you've got a new project. You've made some tremendous breakthroughs, and now you want other young people in this country to be able to make the same breakthroughs.
Yes. Again, thanks for having me. I feel like it's been, I feel like we met and filmed right before things went south. So it's exactly. A pleasure to be back, right?
Right.
But it's an honor. And I think to your point, we've been trying to figure out how do we ensure that folks who are dealing with the same type of experiences, who want to make a change in the world, have the assets, the information, and the tools to be able to do so effectively. Because the world is, you know, I think the world isn't looking for heroes, but is looking for good people who have good ideas, who are ready to put those ideas into action.
Well, I'm sure the young people of America are delighted to hear that, because many of them have really been through such trauma, actually. You know, as I was watching the recent graduations that are taking place in person, all of the students who didn't get to have, you know, the proms, the graduations, the parties, the socialization, and the seeming of success that goes with all of that, you know, now have to put their lives back together again.
That's so true. And I think, you know, some people may see the graduations and the proms as such frivolous activity, but especially for Black folks, right, when there's oftentimes not much to celebrate or not moments in which we can bring our entire communities together to be able to celebrate an accomplishment like a graduation, especially in our communities where so many people lose their lives to gun violence and drugs. I think it's really heartbreaking to see so many young people not being able to fully take in that moment of accomplishing that goal, especially as they hopefully continue their educational journey.
So tell us more about the campaign. I Am Here Too, and you say you want to turn the passion into something productive.
Exactly. So about 2.5 years ago, I met my co-founder, Ariella. We were both honorees for the Vital Voices Global Leadership Award. Ariella is from El Salvador, and we met because we both had brothers who were impacted by violence. Her brother was kidnapped. My brother Andre, as you all know, was shot and killed in Philadelphia. And her path to really thinking about social impact went through the corporate realm. She worked with former gang members in El Salvador to create a company to help them sell merch here in the US to actually raise money to get those young men out of very violent communities. And I went the political or the government realm, where I wanted to change policies and change laws to be able to ensure that the laws and the policies we were putting into place in communities, particularly communities of color, were helpful and not creating additional harm. And so we were throughout the last year, we were really looking at all of the suffering that everyone was dealing with, and how could we move beyond just sharing our story to actually putting the tactics that we employed over the last few years, the conversations that we had with ourselves and with other people, to create tools and resources for those who have experienced pain, who have experienced trauma, or who look at the world and know that there is something deeply wrong and they want to solve it. We wanted to create assets to enable that person to be able to do that first through their own personal development, but then actually creating solutions for change for themselves, their families, and their communities.
Yeah, and one of the things you created was, and one of the things I'm a huge fan of, a sort of daily planner, like how do I get through Monday, and then the next 3 months, and the next year, to sort of plot out, you know, what it is that you're actually going to do to change the world. So talk to us a little bit about what you have to, you know, to offer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we wanted to start with the journal first because, you know, and we want to start with the journal that enabled for people to ask themselves very hard questions. We have this methodology that is our ROTJ, which is return to joy. So are the actions that we're taking, the conversations, the relationships we're cultivating, are the jobs that we have or the jobs that we seek, do these things make us happy? Because what we've learned is that it's easy for someone to, you know, join a cause or to create a campaign or make a business. But what makes those people lack success long-term is the lack of happiness. And we want to start specifically with young people who are, you know, dealing with large amounts of social media influence, constantly feel like they're having to compare themselves to their peers around the world, dealing with like the fear of not living up to the expectations of everyone else.
Sure.
Ask themselves those real hard questions, and that there's hundreds of questions in that journal that really dig deep from everything from, you know, how are you thinking about your health and wellness? Are you thinking about mental health? Are you thinking about your friend circle? Are you thinking about like your aspirations for your job? What is your own mission statement and how you live your values? Because we think that can lay the foundation for how they build their company or build their nonprofit or decide what pathway they want to do in regards to their college degree. So it's really about honing in on those minor details that we oftentimes overlook. We also are doing training with community organizations. We have other assets like our bracelets that are made by young men in El Salvador. And so we tried to have all of our different assets emerge created by organizations that are working with directly impacted people to enable for us to give back, constantly give back to the communities in which we've come from and also communities that are still suffering today.
Right, right. And you and I were part of the prep that our producer director, Audra, was saying, Carol, it's not merchandise, it's merch.
You gotta be cool. You gotta be cool, Carol.
I'm being prepped, you know, I'm being coached and being cool. Young people are buying it, are buying the book there, and you and Ariella are out speaking to them. Talk to us a little bit about the outreach plan for this.
Yeah, so we have two real specific audience. One is the individual person who is trying to seek something within themselves and hopefully change their community. So that's the activist. That's the person who has experienced direct trauma. That is the mom that is sitting home trying to figure out her next step as she goes back into the work field. And then we have organizational change as well as corporate change. And so, you know, one of the things that we found over the last years is that most people don't see themselves as change makers, either because of their specific job title, their background, or their financial status. And what we're trying to hone in is that every single person has the ability and the capability to be able to be a change maker. And so we're working with companies and organizations to help train their employees to, one, what is your ROTJ? How are you making collective impact within your organization and community? And then how can your organization reflect your values to be able to make a bigger change in the communities in which you create product, you create services, and your employees and workers live? And then for the individuals, we are doing where we have an entire curriculum. So when you buy a journal, you have access to about 5 different videos that walk individuals through the journal. We also have a private community on Facebook where folks can ask each other questions, share stories, share additional resources. And then over the next few months, we'll be coming out with a card deck as well as additional merch and resources such as toolkits for change. So whether you want to start your own business, social impact enterprise, or whether or not you want to start your own nonprofit, actually walking people through the steps that we utilize in our everyday lives to be able to be an activated change maker. And through our corporate partnerships, we're hoping to make a lot of those resources and merchandise free to the individual person who may not have the financial means to be able to get access to them. I'm trying to facilitate that opportunity to be free of charge for those folks. And as well you can get the journal either digital or in print. So
there's right. I saw on the website, which is, you know, IamHereToo .com. Go to the website and you can, I saw that's probably a newer thing that the journal, I have stacks of those journals here in my house, you know, but as my son always points out that if I just downloaded, you know, my books.
Exactly. Change the environment one book at a time.
Exactly. One big book at a time. So it's digitally available. So really, you know, even though so much of your work has been aimed at youth, I mean, this is really for everybody, you know, and useful no matter where you are in your career. And you talk about the women who are out of the workforce mm-hmm. by the millions and who, you know, now have to retrain, now have to try to get back on that. Yeah. If it's a corporate ladder, you know, of success. And so, you know, some planning is going to be required. And I think that, you know, what you and Ariella have produced is going to be very, very helpful.
Yeah, and it's the question of, I think the last year, you know, we've all contemplated, like, what makes us happy? Is the job that we're in making us happy? We're overworked, exhausted, and the world seems like it's only getting worse. And so I think that's one of the things that made us move forward as quickly as we did, is that we saw a lot of people suffering and just trying to figure it out.
Right, right. So now, for those who may not have seen our first interview with you, may not know the full story of, you know, the trajectory that, you know, that you took in your life, you know, there are, what, 15 or 16 siblings in your family?
I have 15, yes.
Right.
We're running strong. I have 15 siblings and now officially 27 nieces and nephews. There's a lot of us.
Big, big, big family, you know, and I come from a big family. My mother was one of 15, so we know how that, you know, mm-hmm. exponentially explodes through the generations, you know, but you had, you know, a very, you know, sad, complicated mm-hmm. Life because so many members of your family were involved in yeah. the criminal justice system. So mm-hmm. talk to us a little bit about that, how you broke out and, you know, have become this leader.
Yeah, no, and thank you for allowing me the space for that. So for those who don't know, I'm originally from Philadelphia. My claim to fame is that I went to the same high school as Will Smith. Just, you know, slide that in there. Never met him, but I grew up in West Philadelphia, a community that is deeply, and still to this day, deeply overwritten with, you know, poverty and violence. And I grew up in a household with 15 siblings, 10 older brothers, and I'm the first girl, so I have 5 younger siblings, 2 girls, 3 boys. And I grew up in a house where, you know, for a long time, I assumed the circumstances of my communities was the norm, right? It was normal to see people go to prison, normal to see people lose their life to gun violence. It got to the point where I had become desensitized to what was happening around me. And in 2005, my 20-year-old brother Andre was shot and killed in Philadelphia. And it was also the same year, through the process of trying to notify my father what had happened, that we found out that he was serving life in prison in Virginia. And so I was at a weird juxtaposition as a 15-year-old, knowing both a perpetrator and a victim. And this had come after years of watching many of my older brothers moving in and out of the criminal justice system, including both my parents. And I think the moment that the experience of losing my 20-year-old brother, Andre, awakened me to the problems that I was facing in my community, and also the realization that I didn't want to continue to live like that. I didn't want that for future generations. I didn't want that for my current community to be able to experience those problems. And it was also during the time where no one was really talking about gun violence in the urban community, except in the context of Black on Black crime, right? Black people are inherently violent, which is untrue, right? If we pull back, if we look at any problem within our society, it's like an onion oftentimes, right? So violence and mass incarceration are the public face to much deeper systematic problems. What we're now knowing, what we didn't know at 15, 17 years later, is this idea of patriarchy and white supremacy and how it has infiltrated our communities to create policies and practices that are the root causes of violence in our spaces. And so, you know, through that experience of losing my brother, I became an activist. I created an anti-violence program in my high school that trained high school students how to be violence interrupters. That program later went on to be implemented into the top 10 particularly dangerous high schools, and eventually helped to create the Office of Restorative Justice within the School District of Philadelphia. It catapulted me. I had no idea what an activist was. I didn't know that I could dedicate my life to this work. And 17 years later, I'm still in it, still finding, you know, ways in which for us to continue to pull back the onion and ask more questions and hopefully create the space for young people to be at a part of the solution building of the conversation.
Actually thought about you during this last year of incredible violence, you know, the George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, Mekhi Bryant, and almost daily, you know, we are seeing incidents where Black people are being killed, sometimes by police. I wonder what your thoughts are on that. Where, how do we solve this problem in the Black community with the law enforcement that is supposed to be there to protect people?
I'm happy you use that word, supposed to be, right? So I have a unique career trajectory in the sense that I was working for Mayor Michael Nutter in Philadelphia during the Ferguson protests. We had a lot of protests happening in Philadelphia as a reflection of what was happening in Ferguson. And then later on, I went to work for Amnesty International, where I led their domestic portfolio focus on police brutality. And what we learned through that process is that there are 16,000 police forces across the country, and the vast majority of them are operating as individual entities. There is no national policy on the use of force standards that allows police officers oftentimes to get away scot-free and treat people however they want to treat. I say that also as someone who sat on two police oversight commissions, one in Philadelphia and one in Washington, D.C. And what I can tell you is that the institution of police is inherently racist. It is inherently racist at its core, in its policies and its practices and its requirements of how police officers should be policing specific communities. And so, you know, people may say it's controversial to say defund the police, but we have been defunding every single other public institution for decades, whether we're talking about public education, whether or not we're talking about public services, our public roads. And so I think we're at a moment where in this country, we're beyond just Black folks. If we take anything from the protests that happened over the summer, where white allies literally put their bodies in between Black protesters and police, we're finally understanding that the institution of police does not make us safe, and that we need to reevaluate what safety means in this country, while also having, of course, some level of enforcement, because we have laws to enforce. But the fact that we have communities of color, particularly poor communities, being over-policed by police officers, which inherently creates more of a violent environment, does not help. And so what I would love for us to see is that for this country to have an honest conversation about race, about how the institution of police can be traced all the way back to slavery, right? We're now in the process of hearing stories of what happened during the Tulsa massacre. We know that there are many examples of that around the country. Many of those massacres were led or overlooked by police. And so it's deeply troubling what we're seeing, especially because one would think that if a perpetrator is being filmed on camera, they would try to do something different, but police only seem to be, you know, intensifying their violence. And so, I think it's a battle to get the president and his administration on board to be able to see that how Black people describe safety is not the same way how our institutions have described it for so long. And we need to reevaluate how we're putting, how we're being proactive versus reactive to very real problems in our cities, in our states, and in our country.
Just your last comment, you know, your thoughts on the Biden-Harris administration, because, you know, many people in this country were waiting for them to come make substantial changes. Are you convinced that those changes will take place?
You know, I was really involved in the 2020 election. I was a Warren supporter. I was a Warren delegate. And then I became a Harris supporter, a Harris and Biden delegate. And then I spoke at the DNC. And, you know, there was a lot of folks around the country who did not want to vote, who did not want to be a part of the process because they believed that the policies that both Biden and Harris would put forth wasn't reflective of how progressive we needed them to be. And I think based on some of the comments that have since come forth with both Biden and Vice President Harris and President Biden saying that America is not a racist country, or what they're saying that we need to wait into all the evidence in some of these police incidents as if these things are not on camera, as if we don't have dozens if not hundreds of incidents of police brutality. You know, I'm trying to be hopeful. James Baldwin said, I have no choice but to be optimistic as a Black American. But in the same breath, you know, I think it's our requirement as Black voters, as individuals within this country who claim to want to see a better version, to keep putting pressure on the administration to do more and be better, and also to remind them who got them there. The Democratic Party has a deep, deep thinks and needs to have a deep respect for Black women. We come from Black families, Black communities, and our issue is to continue to keep our communities safe. And we don't need lip service from an administration that looks for us on election day and then forgets us throughout the entire administration. And I do think some of the progress is happening.
Jamira, those are tough words, you know,
for somebody
who worked so hard and spoke at the DNC and all. Lip service, you think that's what's happening?
I think in some instances there is a lot of lip service. And prime example, what we're seeing even with the recent legislation passed by for Asian American hate, we've been trying to get similar legislation passed for Black people for decades, right? It is still legal it is still not illegal to lynch Black people in the United States. And so I think for Black people who feel bitter in a time where we put this administration, where we came out in numbers that like they've never seen before, I think it's disappointing for people to see what's happening with communities that we love and respect in the Asian space, to see them get this legislation to support them, while also looking at the fine print, knowing that that legislation potentially could be used to more police communities of color and to continue to create divide between us. And so I think more work needs to be done. I'm hopeful. I have a lot of, respect and love for many of my colleagues who are in the administration, who are doing amazing work and who are opening doors behind the scenes and are having those conversations. But until Black folks are not unjustly killed by police, until Black folks can walk down the street and know that they're not going to be their encounter with police may turn deadly, or know that resources are adequately distributed across this country, I'm going to continue to say that an administration that was put into office by Black folks, until we have that kind of legislation, is only lip service.
Wow. And so Black women in particular, young Black women like you and older Black women, I wouldn't say like me, but at any rate, my age, who work so hard. You think that the evidence is not there, that there is enough gratitude for what was done by the Black community?
Not yet. It's still early in the administration. We're a little over 100 days. Not yet. I think there's a lot of work to be done. I do think a lot of progressive conversations have happened, particularly with the investment in gun violence prevention in particularly urban communities. There was $10 billion that were invested, going to be invested over the next few years, a lot of that money going to communities of color. But at the same time, I'll wait until the fine print is evident. I'll wait until the results come in, because, you know, the details are, or the results are in the details. And I think we've been shunned and mistreated for so long that I think it's right for us to be skeptical, and it's right for us to continue to ask for more and demand more of this country.
So one of the things that's stopping some progress that the Biden administration has proposed is the Republicans in the Senate. Yeah. What are your thoughts on the filibuster and how the Biden administration should go forward from this point on?
Yeah, the filibuster has to go. The Electoral College has to go. They are inherently racist. They are inherently put into place to allow a very small majority of this country to have half of the authority. And I think that's wrong. And I think what we're seeing now, a lot of the policies that Biden wants to get passed, his administration wants to get passed, is being held up by the filibuster. And I think if we're trying to get folks out in less than 2 years, if we're trying to get folks out in less than 4 years, we have to have something to show for it. We have to say that you put us into office and these are the results that we were able to get. And if we allow ourselves to play politics with a party that never played politics with us over the last 4 years, that look for every opportunity to oppress more people of color, we are going to be in the same place that we were in 2016, where we could potentially lose the election or lose the House and Senate. And so, yeah, I say get rid of the filibuster now to enable for Biden to be able to, you know, bring his policies, his practices to the light, because otherwise it's not going to motivate people to want to go out and vote again if they don't feel like they got anything or their lives haven't changed in any small or large way.
Well, I think you put the Biden-Harris administration on notice, Jamira Burley. Thank you so much for coming to talk with us about your, not only about politics and, you know, the lives we're living and what needs to happen, but about your prescription for joyful living in the midst of all of this. The program is I Am Here Too, mm-hmm. and you can get the journal and the merch at IamHereToo.com.
Jamira, you said that really well. Thanks again for having me.
I'm practicing. I'm gonna get to it. Thank you so much, Jamira Burley, for everything that you've done and for your advice and for what you've created in your own life. And thanks so much to you all too for joining us. I'm Carol Jenkins. The program is Black America, and we will see you the next time.